Ilan Chabay, I hope I pronounced that right. The first time I met Ilan Chabay was at a dinner during the Complexity System Conference in Amsterdam in September last year. That dinner was organized by Stuart Kaufman, a very small old restaurant in the center of Amsterdam. And it was to celebrate his birthday, but also the fact that he had 55 years ago also been in that same restaurant. So it was very nice, and we had a very nice conversation. And as the conversation progressed and the discussion became more and more lively, then Ilan started to talk about his wilderness adventures in Alaska and in Nepal. And that is the kind of adventures that you read about in books that you cannot put down. And it was really audacious adventures into the wilderness. And there were very thrilling stories. And after that, we got to talk about Beyond Boundaries, which was very much in line with these thrilling stories. And he got interested in paralimas, and I decided, and I very quickly realized that he would be a great speaker for today, because he has demonstrated survival skills, and he also has a deep insight in the existential challenges that humanity faces during a very rapidly changing conditions in the world, on Earth, and that reality is largely being created by humanity itself. So, instead of saying anything more, please help me welcome Ilan Chabay.
Wonderful. Well, thank you very much for the follow-up to that wonderful dinner and the opportunity to be here and to speak with all of you. This has certainly already, for me, been a fantastic experience. And I came here knowing there was a risk that I would learn something. And indeed, it has happened. So as with the adventures, I'm all for taking risks, interesting ones. I won't talk about the adventures in British Columbia, Alaska, Everest, et cetera, but I will talk about the challenges before us in a very serious sense, but also one that requires not just the science, but the true engagement with the society, because it is for the society and with the society that we need to be doing this kind of science. That is more on that, what science, I will talk about as we go. So the pieces that I want to talk about are that living in the Anthropocene, and I'll come back to what that means in a moment, we're in a period of unprecedented and very rapid change on both the global but also local scales. And there are lots and lots of examples, and I will show some of these. But these are complex issues, and complex not only in what they are, but in the way that we as human beings deal with them and think about them and learn about them and communicate about them. So we need ultimately to change behaviors and to transform societies towards sustainable futures. And I use the word sustainable futures, not sustainable development, not sustainable future, singular, because it is locally context dependent. And we cannot forget that, and we cannot avoid it. It means there is a concomitant change in the kind of science that we do, the so-called, what is now the current happy buzzword of transdisciplinary. We'll get back to that shortly. But it also requires new, I believe, coherent trajectories of learning and education. And I'll come back to that, of course. So, what do I mean by Anthropocene? The Anthropocene epoch was a term, the Anthropocene was coined by Paul Crutzen in 2000. Paul Crutzen won the Nobel Prize in 1995, primarily for his work on atmospheric chemistry and understanding the nature of the ozone hole, but also has contributed to a number of other things, primarily in atmospheric chemistry. But in a meeting, he basically kind of popped up this term, and it stuck. stuck to the degree that now the question of stratigraphy, the layers of Earth on a geological level, is being debated. Is that really a new era, as opposed to the Holocene in which we were considered to be part of? But the real issue is not whether it is officially and recognized by the Stratigraphic Institute or not, but that human actions, us, collectively, over time, have made changes in the Earth, on the Earth, in the conditions that are actually recognizable on a global scale. If you think about, for example, you may know of the huge plastic islands floating in the middle of the ocean. Well, they're not just in the middle of the ocean. They've begun to form layers of microbeads of plastic as layers, just as if you look in the fossil record and you find a layer and you can date it by knowing where it is in that layer. When the multiple alien civilizations come to visit in a couple of thousand years, they will find the layer at which this Anthropocene began, where we really had massive impact on our global environment, geologically, chemically, biologically, for better and worse. And that's not something that's just happened like that, but there has been a change in that. But what it does, and that's really the point that I want to stress, is it changes the way we need to think about our own agency and our responsibility. By agency, I mean our capacity and our belief in our capacity to have an influence, to act in a way. Are we able to do something? How do we see that? That's what I mean by agency. But it means then coping with the complexity of these social ecological systems. So it's not only changing, it's changing very rapidly. And there is an onset that is generally recognized to be, and it can be depending on which indicator. On one side, these are mostly things from Will Steffen and others now, but starting with Will's work. Starting from the 50s and earlier, and you see suddenly very rapid rise in the various indicators. I don't know if they're really visible here, but just, I mean, there are many. And you can look on, let's look here, carbon dioxide levels, nitrous oxide, methane, surface temperatures, ozone in the stratosphere, marine fish capture, tropical forest loss, domesticated land, etc. But also on the other side, primary energy use, real GDP, world population, a major factor, obviously, overall, water use, telecommunications, transportation, etc. So it is not only those physical parameters that have changed and are changing at an accelerated rate, but it is also what we are doing in interacting with that, the social and ecological factors. So these are one set of, if you will, visual reminders, indicators of these kinds of changes. And there are many that have been worked out far more in detail than you can see here or they're shown here. But the point is the same, that it is not only that it is rapid, but it is unprecedented. What does that mean? Well, it means I can't go and look, let's see, what chapter was that in? What am I supposed to do now? Where do I look it up? Doesn't work. We need to learn our way into addressing these things, which is why I want to come back to learning and education towards the end. The other set of things that have caused quite a bit of attention and concern, rightly so, are these planetary boundaries, which was first proposed in a paper in 2009 and has been somewhat modified but expanded, in fact, basically saying that there are a number of parameters in the in what we can see of the Earth's conditions, physical, biological, geological, that are very worrying, shall we put it that way, that we are approaching limits in the resources and in the use of those resources that are essential for our environment. Sometimes you say to people, you know, talking about the ecological system, oh, yeah, I know about that. There's a really nice forest over there a few kilometers. Uh-uh. What are you breathing? What are you wearing? What are you drinking? What are you eating? We are embedded in that, always. We cannot avoid it. If we destroy it, we are sunk or cooked. So climate change, genetic biodiversity, nitrogen flows, ozone loss, ocean acidification, land use change, all of these things, and certainly the last one on the list there, novel entities, plastics, radioactive materials, nanomaterials. These are just indications on a global level of the kinds of boundaries in that sense, the limitations that we have to come to terms with. And there's certainly limitations in terms of specific materials, but it's not only in do we have enough of whatever it is, but where is it? How is it distributed according to the needs of humanity? And who gets it and who doesn't? And what do we do with the waste? Whether it's waste food, which is an enormous amount, waste, solid waste materials, toxic materials. We take the toxic materials, we ship it off, and somebody else unloads it, takes care of it. Not such a good idea, but that's actually very commonly done. So out of all these concerns, actually starting earlier in 1987, there was this effort to talk about sustainable development goals, and that started in terms of public awareness to some degree anyway, with the Brundtland Report, Our Common Future, and in 1987. And I was part of a group that, about six or seven of us, that put together at the request of the Norwegian Foreign Ministry a sort of reprise of the Brundtland Report in 2007, presented to the UN. The question was, okay, 20 years later, why are we worse off? What happened? What didn't we do? What should we be doing? And for me, that was also a very important experience in working together also with people from very different backgrounds. Maybe it's worth my saying that my background originally was physical science, was laser physics and chemistry, spectroscopy, and I have, because of these kinds of questions, I wouldn't say I've gone over to the dark side completely, though some of my colleagues may say that, but I'm somewhere in between, and I think that's actually crucially important, to be able, that at least there are people who are crossing those boundaries, not planetary boundaries, but disciplinary boundaries, to address these kind of things, because we have this in the usual representation, social, ecological, and economic issues coming together, creating, if you will, a small domain which may be where we could be sustainable. And by sustainable in this sense, it doesn't mean that I can keep the company running and make a good profit. It means that society functions in a way that it can remain viable under changing conditions. It is not about stasis and saying that now we just fix everything and we're cool. The world will continue changing, and the question is how do we continue mitigating the negative effects, adapting and learning in order to do that. There is another representation here that was done, which economics, politics, culture, and ecology. One could slice it up lots of different ways. That's not really important for our purposes right now, other than to say that these involve multiple aspects. And I want to come back to that, culture, ecology, politics, and economics. But generally, these are interacting complex systems in which the complexity is not only in the external conditions, but in the internal issues of human beings engaged with this process. In September 2016, the UN adopted these 17 Sustainable Development Goals. And the response was, okay, we have these planetary boundaries and we've got to address this question of sustainable futures. And I, again, stress the plural, but they still use the term sustainable development. Still bugs me, but okay. But there are 17 of these goals laid out. Some of them are fairly specific, some of them are very broad and very general. But from poverty, hunger, well-being, education, gender equality, clean water, and affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth. That's an interesting point there. Industry, innovation, and infrastructure. And I do want to come back to the question of innovation. Reduced inequalities, which unfortunately what we see are expanding inequality in many cases, in many ways. Sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption and production. That's by the way, one of the things about the responsible consumption and production, there is a knowledge action network that I'm part of as part of Future Earth, which is systems of sustainable consumption and production. And again, the idea that these are systemic issues and are important to think of in those terms. Climate action, life below water, life on land, peace, justice, and strong institutions, partnerships for these goals. Wonderful. So we have a great set of goals. Can't really argue with them overall, though with certain pieces of it. My question with the planetary boundaries, an argument I've had with Johan Erkstrom for 9 or 10 years now, is yeah, that's this big imperative. And he says, look at these planetary boundaries. We have to change. And my response is, yes, I get it. How? How do we do that? He said, but we have to change. Yes, how do we do it? So the question then is, what is that process that we have to engage in to actually make the changes that that get us towards these laudable goals and that keep us within those planetary boundaries? Well, a few remarks just to put it in context. Society, these are nothing that you don't already know, but it's helpful sometimes to put it down explicitly. Society as a system is inextricably linked with and embedded in the natural systems on which we're dependent. Again, goes back to the ecology. Society and its built environments comprise a complex system interacting with complex systems of the natural world. Life gets complex. But what is important in this also is that we, in the societies, in different communities, in different ways, define what is relevant in the relationship to the environment. What do matters? And as you probably are well aware, different cultures relate to their environment in very different ways and speak about it in different ways, have different terms to describe their relationship with the environment, indeed different terms to highlight or diminish the relationship to certain aspects of their society. And that affects then the way they engage with ecology, with biodiversity, with their resources. So it depends, to come to the point here in a way from the whole conference, that that's what the reality is described by the way that how people conceive, both individually and collectively in communities and societies, their idea of reality, how they work with that. And thus, importantly, their agency and responsibility. And that's equally true if you think of it as in the talk, several talks that we've heard, whether it's about financial systems, military systems, schools, learning, whatever. It has to do with the way we see what it is we want from the society and what we do in reacting or responding to that, the agency and responsibility. And this, as I've just said, that the unprecedented and rapid rate of change means that this only way to deal with this is through learning, not by going back to the drawing board that said, oh, we were supposed to do this, or the chapter 23 in the book of life that says, do that when this happens. We don't have that. But that learning process is what leads us both to adaptation and mitigation, but also to socially relevant innovation. And there's a lot of question about how that develops. More on that later. So the goals, just to reiterate, it indicates these probable limits of the resource. It doesn't tell us what to do about staying there. The goals tell us the desirable attributes of our society globally and locally over a period of time. But each sector, business, community, individual, defines, envisions sustainable future in its own context. If I'm working with groups in Nuuk, Greenland, and they have an idea about how their livelihoods, their environment, their transportation across permafrost, et cetera, fishing, hunting, oil development, mineral development, how that should shape their future, that doesn't tell me much about what should be going on in the Kimberley slum in Nairobi. So it is very much context dependent, and it's dependent on the stakeholders to develop that. So again, coming to learning how to change behavior in order to make these transformations in society in different contexts. And to do that, I started about 9 years ago in a kind of peculiar way, but it worked, to start research alliance on knowledge, learning, and societal change. Because to me, the issue was not simply the learning, not simply the knowledge, the usual trope of, you know, knowledge to action, and you know where there's a gap there, but you know, don't worry too much. Just jump, make a big jump, and you'll get there. Well, no, sorry. What's in the gap is the process of making meaning and using the knowledge in a way to initiate, support, drive, if you will, or catalyze change. So what is it about that? And the mission of this alliance is to identify and understand the conditions under which collective behavior change towards specifically, I mean, to add the terms just and equitable, sustainable futures, either can occur, does occur, or fails, to understand those conditions and to use that understanding then to catalyze or advance solutions and promote action on ways that we can get towards sustainable futures. One small note here is that it's sort of pathways towards or to sustainable futures. We don't know what that is. Not only is it context dependent, but again, we don't have a prescription for that. And we, in my view, probably never will. What we will develop, hopefully, is a set of ideas that help us in specific locations to address these things as they develop, but also a set of generalizations, hopefully, that allowed us to leverage the differences and deal with the different contexts in some more generalizable way. Why do I stress collective behavior change? There are a number of reasons. It's not that it's bad if you take out, you personally take out the garbage and separate it. That's great. But the individual process, if it remains individual, is inadequate to deal with it, partly because of the fact that people, individuals, generally lack a strong sense of agency when the issue is complex, so it's hard to understand, and there are large temporal and spatial scales which they're not seeing generally, I mean directly, because of the feedback, so that's what leads to that kind of complexity. The causality and the impact are uncertain and not necessarily anything immediate or personal. And third, the outcomes, if I act, are not, it's very difficult for me to know, did that do anything? You know, was I effective? Did it matter? You don't know that. And one interesting aspect of this is that, one, if just the individual actions are, if they're uncoordinated, they can be inconsistent, they may be in opposition to it. One area acts in one way, another a different way. So it may be ineffective. It may not. May be effective, but in general may not be. Governance may be insufficient for meaningful, sustained compliance with new ideas and changes unless there is a strong base of support from the community that requires a coherence in that community and a development, very importantly, of some kind of concordant social norms. It's a change of those norms of that community that makes that transformation really possible. And to make strategic short-term decisions that have long-term implications requires something where you're not deferring the decision to later when it may be very difficult, in fact, to recover or have very damaging long-term consequences. That said, there's still always the danger you make the decision and there are unintended consequences. That's true. But there's also the unintended or the undesired consequence of being in a situation where we know that there are negative effects, and if we don't do anything, again, we're in big trouble, or we at least locally are. So one maybe comment about the causality, the impacts are uncertain in the earlier part. You can have a social movement, and we have lots of them. We understand quite a bit about social movements from the literature, from many studies for decades at least. But this is different, and it's difficult. It's different if I am involved in a civil rights movement, in a women's rights movement, in a labor movement. It's about my immediate personal part of this story. I know what that is. I get it. That's easy in a sense. I know what its impact on me is likely to be and why I might want to join the union, the movement, the women's march in Washington regarding Trump, et cetera. Okay, that's relatively easy. It's very difficult to mobilize, to motivate, to move together when the target is ill-defined, is complex, the outcomes are uncertain. That's a much tougher problem. And that's why I think it's important for us to try to address it in a different way, in a coherent way. So if we're going to change behavior, there are really three ways, as people in social psychology tell me. One of them, which I think we all recognize, is attention. So if everything's cool and, you know, no problem, I mean, why would I change? You won't. And the problem there is that the tension needs to be there, but that also depends on whether people understand what their current condition implies about their future or their children's future or their grandchildren's future. So it is also related to our understanding and our knowledge, not just to the tension of the current situation. Second thing is the sense of self-efficacy or agency, as I put it earlier, the sense of confidence that if I do something, it actually might matter. I can do something useful. And a sufficient sense of the benefits, whether that is because of social and political resonance or a fit to the norms, that becomes really decisive in whether people will move. We'll come back to some of that. That's basically around motivation. So this quote I rather like, that behavior change is not like buying a different brand of beer. It's about getting people to do things they're uncomfortable with, don't want to do, or can't do, or they'd already be doing it. It is uncomfortable. Change is uncomfortable for most of us if it is more than trivial. I can buy a different brand of toothpaste, big deal, buy a different beer, but that doesn't require anything of me, really. And if we're talking about free societies and you don't have a gun to your head, you can't force these changes in behavior. So that means that to serve the needs, to address needs of people, it's the motives that guide their goal-oriented behavior. So change has to start from the motives, from what it is people act on, and part of that is their worldview or their sense of identity, if you will, and I'll come back to that. By the way, the matter of starting from motives and worldviews is also a critical piece of how one can be supportive and helpful in learning. If you start from where the learner is, rather than where you assume they are or where you want them to be at some point in the future, you have a much better chance of helping them move forward in their own learning. More on that later. So one thing that is categorized here is the idea of highest level, which have universal validity, largely perhaps on self-preservation terms. And you know, whether that's physical, psychological integrity, power, status, exploration, et cetera, but also even reproduction, which includes then in this categorization, attachment, care, altruism, perhaps. At lower levels, if you want to put it that way, that's where things are really susceptible to norms and to the differences in group-specific behaviors and attitudes. So that's where the social values and norms become dominant in that regime. Very simply, that one could change external structures to make these changes. That's dependent on the contextual factors. You can have a direct approach by affecting the internal structures, the mental determinants or factors, if you will. And very briefly, and I'm not going to go through all of these, but just there are lots of things that we stumble on if we're thinking about change. The ones I want to emphasize are the ones in bold, the world views or identity, both of individuals and of communities, but also with the idea that things, that certain ideologies really affect this. If you really believe that, oh, we just have to invent the next great thing and it'll solve the problem and we're done. This sort of technocratic, techno-salvation approach, well, that's a good reason to say, don't bother me, I don't want to change. They'll fix it, no sweat. Whether it's technology or the government or someone else is going to do it. Uncertainty, which is endemic to complexity, is a big factor. And it's not just because you don't quite know what might happen, but because when you don't know, that sense of self-efficacy, agency, and responsibility are equally, in a sense, uncertain. So you don't have a clear mandate to yourself on acting. There are also enormously difficult dilemmas, trade-offs that are always in this. It isn't a matter of just get me the data. The data is a matter of our interpretation. If I give you one of these odd things, a piece of paper with a bunch of lines across it and a bunch of dots on the lines, and I hand you a violin, well, you could, or a piano, whatever you play, trombone. You can play the notes. You can use the data. That doesn't mean you make music with it, because that requires your interpretation of how those things go together. They don't tell you, in that sense, despite the markings of the composer, they don't necessarily tell you, and they don't tell you uniquely, what it is you do to interpret that data. And science does the same thing. It takes data, it interprets it in different ways by different people. And therefore, in many cases, it is conflicted, it is contested. But there are many other factors here that can be discussed as to how these influence things. Well, in the Knowledge, Learning, and Societal Change Alliance. This is a list of 10, and again, I don't need to go through all of them, but the point was that we had a very interesting large symposium on case studies of collective behavior change, in this case in Asia, in island and isolated communities, and there was a reason I chose that. We will do it in other communities and other contexts, but this was first step. And one of the things that came out was, or one of the sets of things, was a set of 10 commandments? No, 10 observations that sort of summarized what we saw in 10 very different case studies. Case studies from Micronesia and dealing with marine protected areas. Case study from the Philippines of people living on a garbage dump and turning this into a really vibrant, very, really amazing community of 25,000 people now, with schools, building, industries, entrepreneurship, projects on health in India, projects on air pollution and climate change in Nepal, a whole set of things. But out of that, what we are looking for, again, we, Eleanor Ostrom, who won the Nobel Prize in 2009 for economics, but really did some amazing stuff in terms of basically of governance. She and Oren Young and several other colleagues have put together a whole set of studies that go, they're focused on governance in particular, but one of the things that Lynn Ostrom kept saying was about polycentric governance. And on one hand, yes, I agree, but it also frustrated me and frustrates others, because then you say, well, yeah, so everything's different. So how do we make progress and learn so that every single situation isn't one case, idiosyncratic case? What are the common pieces that link across those? How do we begin to pull those apart? And in my, from my interest and from KLASICA perspective, it's not only about governance, but again, it's about transformation and social change. So part of it is bottom up and top down, cultural issues, local views, in making people aware of the relationship between the local and the international global sphere. And the implications of that, and vice versa. Very important to me is the process of building a mutual learning structure and environment, culture of mutual learning. A little more of that in a minute. An important point when one looks at all the projects that are going on is, what do you do when the money goes away? As we see in so many cases, nothing, back to zero. Good thing, 3 years, bunch of money. We're happy, we're the NGO, we go away, we've done another project. But what happens long-term, and how do we make those changes intrinsic to the community so that they can remain and remain viable? So I want to give an example quickly now from a project which was transdisciplinary. I was involved in starting this and co-leading it for 3 years, and I'm now sort of outside it simply because of too many other things to do, but my colleagues at the Institute and elsewhere are following up. By the way, I don't think I said, the institute where I am, at Institute for Advanced Sustainability Studies, is in Germany, and that also, one of the agencies that we work closely with is the Alfred Wegener Institute for Global for Marine and Polar Science, which is also in Potsdam, Germany, as well, along with the German Geological Research Center, GFZ. So it's a very interesting environment, but very much dominated by natural science research. And one of the challenges is how do we bridge across that? So hence this transdisciplinary project. The point is in this image is just that the greatest changes on our planet now are happening in the Arctic by a factor of two or three. I mean, the changes are dramatic, are evident every day in nearly every part of the polar regions. And it has accelerated. So it's not only probably what everybody hears about is sea ice extent, but also thickness, but it's also accelerated permafrost melt, positive feedback on climate change because of lack of change in the albedo decreased as the sea ice and snow cover decrease, greater moisture in the Arctic dome, which leads to different patterns of the Arctic lows and flow and therefore effects on the lower latitude jet stream. If you wonder why your flight diverted much further south rather than flying over Greenland, going from Europe to San Francisco, let's say, that's probably why. Animal habitat loss, hence the iconic polar bears. But it also brings new opportunities and risks, expanding resource search and extraction, changing livelihoods, lifestyles, and loss of cultural values of subsistence, food use. So the Classica is about knowledge, learning, and societal change. The knowledge is not just from science, but it's this trying to bring together the knowledge, the wisdom of both traditional, cultural, local, and formal knowledge into a mutual learning and dialogue process. It involves tacit and procedural knowledge, important point, and it also is a very difficult but crucial process of constructing meaning, of making meaning in a way that is engaged across these communities so that there is a shared meaning in it. And producing positive impact and locally relevant outcomes is, again, question of agency responsibility, connecting policy with social process, of building ownership, commitment, and compliance. You can have the policies, but if it's completely corrupt and nobody is doing anything with it and nobody can, it doesn't really help you very much. But it's also about creating a vision of the sustainable future, of the desirable futures in the local but also global context. It's very hard to work hard and make a change and do something if you have no idea where you're going and why you should be doing that. Without the vision, if we cannot help develop that vision in local context, ain't going to happen. So it's the aspect of that that we have not, I think, identified and discussed sufficiently in terms of science broadly, social science certainly, is the importance of empowering narratives. World that are really expressions of our worldview and identity. And by narratives, I don't just mean strings of words. I mean images. Think of Picasso's Guernica and the effect on millions of people's view of what war means. Think of sculptures, of dance, of music, of poetry. It can take all of these forms, but the important part is that it is a way of expressing worldviews and identity. More on that in a bit. Very briefly, because this project is transdisciplinary, it works with stakeholders and rights holders, shareholders. Rights holders just being a very specific term that many of the indigenous communities prefer over stakeholders because they have fundamental rights, fortunately and recently, to the land which has been theirs and the right and the materials upon it. So very briefly, in this project, we've had meetings with all kinds of groups, with rights holders, the head of one of the Alaskan Aleut communities, in fact, I guess all of them, people from OECD, from World Bank, from mining companies in Greenland and Canada, the Rosneft and Gazprom representatives from Russia, the RIPON representatives from the indigenous peoples groups in Siberia, a whole set of these. And very interestingly for me, certainly, I've been in a number of these Sustainable Development Working Group meetings of the Arctic Council. I don't know that you can see it very well, it doesn't matter, but this is one of the, I would say, hopeful pieces of governance, because they really, it is not a government body, but it has had a real impact on the development of governance structures and policy. And I will just for fun share a few photos from about a year ago. It was only minus 33 when I took that picture, centigrade. You take the camera out, you take the picture, you put it back in the pocket and get your hands in your pockets. That is the mandibles, the jawbones of a bowhead whale, about 15 meters high. That's it in daylight by the house of the main, of the chief whaling captain in Barrow. Barrow is on the very north edge. It's the northernmost city in the United States, in Alaska. And it is at the boundary between, to the north, the Arctic Ocean, if you will, on Barents Straits, and the Chukchi Sea. It's a very rich place in terms of wildlife and marine and fish. We did run into a polar bear and mother and two cubs. It's not something you want to come over and say hello, because you would be dinner, quite likely. I don't know how well that's visible, but that's the skull of the bowhead whale behind, in front of the Inupiat Heritage Center, which is really beautiful. And that's where we had our meetings. And in that meeting afterwards, this woman sort of gave us a tour through this wonderful collection of material. But the thing that was important, and from which I learned a lot, is this is not the docent telling the story. She's talking about her husband, who is the chief whaling captain, and what she cooked and how she prepared things for the last hunt last year, and why it failed because the ice started breaking up, and her husband said, we've got great targets, we're dead if we do it, we're gonna stop, we're going home. And what also became clear there and elsewhere is that it's not about the subsistence food, simply. It's about the social cohesion that comes from food as a cultural matter. And that's something we have to be aware of also. That's just an interesting glimpse of the sun is here behind. There's a sun dog, or the half of a sun dog, ice crystal scattering from the sun, as opposed to a rainbow, in which case the sun would have been behind me. This is in Gwich'in in Fort Yukon, which is Athabascan Native as opposed to Inuit, and I won't go into it, but again, we were welcomed at a tribal council meeting, a group of us, and turned out to be extremely interesting, again, in understanding what the issues are for them, and then asking, what can we do in support of that? What's the process? Very schematically and very quickly, let me just say, what I want to emphasize is that the research domain is not, you know, just let's go talk to the stakeholders and they tell us what to do. No, you have areas of competence. You take that competence, you say, here's the general area I want to work in. Then you go with the stakeholders, map them, characterize them, the power relationships, resource, et cetera, engage with them. And then this critical part, which includes the interpretation of data. And that goes on to developing scenarios, allowing for decision-making that is appropriate to the context. So I've talked about transdisciplinary. There's obviously the sort of single discipline that many of us began with or still are in. It's essential. It's very deep. It's reductionist in nature. There's interdisciplinary research, which many of us also are engaged in, and which allow for forming new grounds, new areas between fields. Complexity science is certainly one of those. And transdisciplinary, which works across this, but requires the humility and the trust as part of that. And where the research is driven by the needs and the visions of the stakeholders, and it's conducted with and through them, from the very beginning through the entire process. And my point here is that the monodiscipline or interdisciplinary science is and research is absolutely necessary. It's not like that goes away, but it is not sufficient to deal with some of these socially engaged and embedded problems. But that means that the social contract of science, what is science, it's inescapably normative, even though many people deny that coming from background, because we never mentioned that in college or in many places. And it is basically ethically subjective. You have a choice about what you work on. You have a choice about who funds it. You have a choice about what might be the implications of that. And people make very different choices. But the point is only to recognize that that is inevitably the case. We're not doing objective science. I once gave a talk in Brussels and made a comment about this, and I was immediately challenged by two of my colleagues, and one of them certainly a good friend. They said, no, it's about the truth. I said, yeah, and how do you know? I mean, that's what we're looking for, but we ain't there yet. I don't think we will be. But we are also looking, always looking for that. So we need a transformative science to get to the sustainable futures with justice and equity. I think I've touched on these other than narratives, and just more importantly, just this interesting aspect in my mind in dealing with complexity because of the limitations of human working memory, basically, we must use models. We cannot hold reality, whatever we think that is, in our limited brains. And the usual thing is, you know, well, we deal with half a dozen ideas, pieces of information at one time in our brain. I'm lucky if I manage to. But it's crucial that these are understood, what the models are and what they are not, what the limitations and strengths are. And then on the other side, the narratives are the way we express many of those approximations of models, output of them, or the way we see the world, if you will. But we express it in an affective way, an emotional way. Why are songs, poems, paintings important and powerful? Because they actually affect the way we feel and not just the cognitive process. And handing somebody a thick scientific report and saying, it's really important, read it, please, has a very different effect than a really powerful narrative, either for or against. One of my favorite examples of this in a negative way, I mean, there is a very positive, I Have a Dream, which came out of a long, very powerful, wonderful sermon, I would almost call it, a speech of Martin Luther King, which I remember very well. I worked for his organization in Georgia at the time, actually a year or two after. But it's all, on the other hand, the negative thing is that the state of Kansas, 3 years ago, passed a law outlawing sustainability and Agenda 21. This is a state in drought for decades, and they outlaw sustainability? Excuse me? What's wrong here? Well, the point is not the science. It has nothing to do with the science. Nothing to do with it at all. It has to do with the idea of American exceptionalism. Nobody's going to come in from the outside and tell us that we can't drive our cars, we can't live in our own separate big house. We have to ride bicycles, whatever. It's that, not the science. Let me quickly, in the last few minutes, if I may, talk briefly about learning. The point is, I think we need to change the expectations and we need to change the narrative of science in the learning process so that we have people who are prepared to work in this transdisciplinary manner and help in developing transformative science. So what I think is crucial is the idea of and much of this is not new. It's just I think we really have to instantiate this on a much broader level. And from early childhood learning, preschool, all the way through to the university, to create much more of a coherent trajectory of learning throughout life and lifelong. So learner-centered learning, teachers as coaches and continuing learners that stimulate and nurture curiosity. The experiential learning provides a vocabulary for thinking and to understand and use representations in regard to the reality, whatever that is. Much of that involves building processes, building models, either conceptual models or physical ones, but which help in understanding and approaching that. Very quickly, I will go through a few examples, and then you get to play with one. I don't know how well you can see that. That's a group of kids in Philadelphia, middle school kids. I think you can see the faces are sort of, that's a wonderful beginning point. Because then they have the questions, not me. And you can't stop them. They just keep going, and they want to know what's going on. But it's not just the kids. Look at these two women. It's the same experiment. And the point of this is not teaching people something, but engaging them actually with the frozen bubble box in doing science in an authentic way. I don't answer questions. I give them tools to test their model. Why do the bubbles float? Why do they freeze? What happens to the size of them in that box in the matter of minutes? But to go on quickly, this is the ping pong pinball where you do chemistry to fire a ping pong ball 15 meters in the air and then play the ramps. This was in a housing community development center in Chicago. And I mean, when the end of the day, I tried to pick this up and walk off with it, and the kids kept cranking. I couldn't stop them. But what's not obvious is the kind of exchange and social process going on with them. I'm going to skip over this and talk about engaging teachers. This is also the ping pong pinball, different view, in trying to help them understand what inquiry-based learning is. This was a truck on the energy transition that Ordner-Wren and I designed with exhibits around the interactive exhibits like ping pong pinball around the outside, and a game in the middle in which one actually plays with change making, using energy. But the key piece is this, oops, where is it now? Well, anyway, the boy on one end, and there's another at the other end, is the one who's supplying the power for everybody to be playing. So the more power they use in their virtual house, the more they have to crank, and at some point, if it is uncoordinated, it is impossible to turn the crank. The torque's too high. Then you stop, and then the questions begin. So last, as a, whoops, why am I, there it is, a coda, if you will, last couple of slides, group of nursery or kindergarten kids playing with an object, which I brought a version around, one that I built some 30 years ago now. It was one of my early prototypes. It's still around, and you're welcome to play with it shortly. But what's interesting is the dialogue here. It's not just the kids are playing. They're talking to each other about it. This guy's working on his own. Boys versus girls, maybe, but nonetheless. Well, okay, so here they are in kindergarten. Here's a gentleman playing with the same thing. I had to stop him and finally say, sorry, would you please rejoin the rest of this meeting? This is about 3 years ago at the Institute. That gentleman, and hence the coda, is Paul Crutzen. And his response was, no, wait a minute, I have to do another experiment. And so I rather like the juxtaposition between these two pictures. So with that, is this the end? Well, I hope not. I hope it's only the initial steps towards a sustainable future. Thank you.
Thank you, Ilan, for your nice talk. You made it not easy for yourself. The theme you have chosen was collective change. How to do that, how to come to collective change when it comes to Anthropocene. And that, I'm saying that why are you making it so difficult for yourself is saying you cannot look here at examples we tackled before. Because the Anthropocene, in your words, is unprecedented. That's the way you started. So by doing this, by giving this, framing your problem, you almost isolated yourself from the world, and from policy making and from strategy and whatever. You say, listen, you can talk with me, but not come up with examples from before because they are all wrong. Something like that. That's what I picked up. And I'm checking it with you, whether I'm right or not. And I'm trying to ask you to test it by giving you a situation and see what you're going to say then. Donald Trump is asking you in his office and is saying to you, please, Ilan, could you come? I really have a big problem with that Anthropocene of you. And I think there is a big problem. And but the way you're talking and everyone is talking is making it so huge and so difficult. And everything has to change completely. This is too much for me. And so could you say now to me, Ilan, could you say, Trump, eh? Yeah. And I'll tweet it immediately after you have said it. And could you say to me then, what are the three do's and the three do nots when I want to achieve your collective change? And so that's my question. What would you refer to, and what would you give him as the three do's and do nots?
A really interesting question, and I it's very helpful because I put it in the wrong context. The point is that it is unprecedented change. It does not mean there is nothing we learn from where we are and past policy, et cetera. The question is, what parts of that do we use in what way in moving forward, and how do we organize that in such a way that it is context decision? I mean, look, the UN has the Sustainable Development Goals, and they're global. But each country is, in fact, responsible for their own targeting of those goals. And indeed, it probably goes to even smaller divisions. So part of it is dealing with this in local context. Two is, yes, we can learn from, for example, prior policy, social movements, you know, common fisheries policy, whatever you want. Those are all examples, but which in many cases are still not adequate to address a longer term trajectory of unsustainability. The energy transition in Germany, the Energiewende, is another example. Okay, so we're going to make this change. We're going to go away from nuclear, except what we steal from France. We're going to do the following things. Great. But in fact, that leaves many questions unanswered about how people are going to react. So there's this tension between southern Germany and northern Germany. There's supply up north, there's demand down south. So where does the transmission line go? And who's going to support that or not support it? I mean, that's what I'm trying to get at. It's not that there, and I appreciate that perhaps I stated it in that sense too dramatically or too in too much of a dichotomy. It isn't, but it also can't be left at the point that, well, we've done this before, it works, we'll just do that again. There is an evolution in this. That's my point.
Thank you. Thanks, Ilan. A phrase is coming to my mind that I hope is useful. It's something like fulminant becoming. It's in what you're talking about. It's in what George talked about the first day that I talked about. It was in Stefan's talk yesterday. Yeah. There are something that we might want to call interest groups. It could be, in George's case, one of his firms and the people running the trucks and the taxis. In your case, it's the Inuit and the surrounding communities and what they may want. In Stefan's case, it's the banks and the communities and how they form networks with one another. In my case, it's proto-organisms making worlds with one another. And it's back to Agricola in James' talk, of a fulminant becoming that almost can't be said. Something is going on in which agencies are coming together in different levels of agencies that create their worlds with one another, create their interests with one another, and become in ways that can't be said, and it just keeps changing. This bears on what do we mean by science. So a couple comments, or maybe one. In your gut, you have 550 bacterial species or something. That's an ecosystem. They're making their worlds with one another. They're making livings with one another. Mm-hmm. The relevant issues for bacterial species one depends upon the other species that are around. Mm-hmm. The relevant issues for fish, when there were only fish and no mammals, were different with one another than there are once there's mammals or marsupials in Australia. We all have interests with one another depending upon what we become. Mm-hmm. What we become. The firms that Stefan's talking about, banks, weren't around 1,000 years ago. These things became and formed new interactions with one another. Mm-hmm. And that's what's going on now, too. It raises a funny question of what do we mean by science? We're becoming as we do it. It's not just static and standing there. It's all becoming.
Completely agree. And I mean, it's a really important point. I think that's sort of in this nature of this unprecedented, but also about the sense that it is not, let's solve the problem now, and then we're done. We're, you know, when we've got it fixed. We don't, and we won't, for exactly the reasons you say. But I think I will think more about it, Sue, because I like, I mean, the way you put it also with your wonderful proto creatures. I mean, I love the story, but I think that...
The first raptor.
Absolutely. I love stories anyway. Go back to narratives, okay? The point of what your story is, it's also a very powerful way of communicating the ideas. And I think what I'm trying to get at is that that change means that both in the way we educate, learn, and the way we do science, whatever that is itself changing and needs to. So I completely agree. Thank you.
Thanks for your talk. Always depressing when one hears these subjects being shown to you. But a question I have is, you said you know we have to innovate, we have to change, etc. What I saw you show didn't seem to be very innovative in terms of the projects, you know, where we're going to analyze and then we're going to write papers, which is what your chart had at the bottom, you know, write papers, make presentations, etc. That doesn't seem to be very innovative. The getting people together and talking doesn't seem to be very innovative. I'm just wondering, with all of the things that you've done and all of the ideas that have been proposed, and maybe building on the question about what are the three things, you know, has anything emerged in your experience in this journey which is innovative, which could actually make a difference, which isn't about doing analysis and writing papers or getting people together and talking and sharing, you know, Viceboard and Jenner, Future Search, it's not innovative. Has anything come out that you've seen that really is innovative, that's really jumped up and said, oh wow, this is, even though it can be completely wacky, that you feel could be exploited, expanded, and make a difference?
Important question. I think two things. Again, I guess I failed to communicate very well. My point in that diagram was from the top to the very bottom that I'm trying to work with scientists who are very, number one, largely natural science and largely very much in a traditional approach. And so part of the point is to say, no, it's not that you can't write papers, but the really important part was on the lower right, which said we end up with a different set of decisions by the community, not by us.
What decisions have you seen that have come out of the process, even though they may be small, they may be local, that you've seen emerge which really are innovative and do make a difference, however small those differences may be? Because, you know, the butterfly effect and emergence and all of that, we're dealing with complexity, so it may be a small thing, but actually it could grow.
Two examples I can give you. One, because I talked about the Arctic, about working with communities where, as one mayor, the mayor of a Russian Siberian village said to me in a meeting, I mean, through it, my graduate student who speaks Russian, said that I'm squeezed. I don't understand. What do you mean? He said, well, I have very specific requirements and I have very limited budget, but I know my people here and I don't know how to make the decisions because everything seems to be going in different directions. And the process that we engaged with them was meant and did address that so that it at least gave a better representation of what the trade-offs were. And that's what he meant in a sense by being squeezed and why he was eager to use the kinds of approach that we took by working with the community in making choices. For example, how much money do you put into infrastructure given possibility of permafrost melt? Another example, which is maybe on even a larger scale, but similar thing, I started the Polish Fisheries Roundtable in 2009, I think, and still running on its own. I was involved for about 2 years. It's now independent. Originally, there was no culture of analytic discourse. He who yelled loudest, longest won. and I do mean he. That was it. We introduced a whole set of things around problem reframing, joint fact-finding, polling, etc. And the result is that the fishermen and the environmentalists, for example, still think the other is the devil incarnate, but they still always show up for the meetings because they agree that they're learning something, and it made a big impact on their ability as from a national level to make coherent input for the common fishery policy reform in 2012. And they were not in any position to do so prior. So those kind of things I do see as having an influence.
So maybe this isn't unprecedented at all, because the content may be unprecedented, but what I hear you say is sort of what I would call a very proven approach to solving
Absolutely.
Problems, which is collective problem solving, cross-boundary,
Absolutely.
You know, the standard facilitation skills needed, etc. And maybe then the how is not unprecedented at all, but perhaps what we do need is a raising of awareness for the pain-gain equation. And I think that's where the key thing is. You know, we want all the, you know, the pain-gain. It doesn't affect me. You know, okay, I live in Shanghai. It does now because I'm breathing polluted air. And perhaps we're going to get a lot more coming out of China because they have a lot more pain with this stuff than anybody else. But I'm just thinking perhaps there needs to be some very consistent communication so that the Trump deniers, et cetera, saying, well, this is all a Chinese plot, can actually be shown to be alternative facting their way through life.
Just to be clear, I did not say that the methods or what we can use are unprecedented. The issues, the problems to be addressed are. And some of them are, you know, known, but many of them that we face in the global context are unprecedented. But of course, I mean, we use what we can use. And these are.
The thing that worries me is it enough? And, you know, do we have to do something? I don't know.
That's one of the questions.
New problem, old solution. Yeah.
We have another question.
Well,
here.
We heard, you know, from Stefan and others really interesting new solutions. Those have to be brought in. But the question is how to do that in a way that also addresses the needs and the different contexts in which those can be instantiated.
Okay, we have another question here.
Yeah, thank you for the very good talk. I perhaps need your help because while going through your talk, that evolved in my mind is globally, are we in search of a new economic vision or paradigm other than the one that has sort of started since the Industrial Revolution from Europe? I can't help, but this thing keeps on bugging me because you talk to any developing country, which I spent years working with them, especially in the region. E-waste, the phone, we all know that there's one version after the others coming out, and all the others, chemical waste and so forth. So all these contribute to the type of challenges you talk about. So do we now actually need to work on a new economic paradigm? That means the whole economic teaching of economic development or econ theory had to really totally reform. Thank you.
Well, I guess my sense is yes, we do. And the question is, how do we get there? I mean, I think as with some of these, we have a lot of reasons to believe that we have to change. And whether it is in the economic system or it's in the educational system or it's in the political structures, governance, what is it that allows or supports or catalyzes that kind of change? That's what I think is the question I'm trying to address. I can't answer. I mean, I don't have the expertise to say what that change should be. That has to be both from the expertise of people who are in this room and elsewhere, but also from what the needs in the context really are, and being aware of those needs and not creating, if you will, once again, a one-size-fits-all top-down imposed system which doesn't work.
Hello, Purisamy. That's my name. Now, it looks like we are losing the war. And not only that, each battle that we mount to try and win the war for a greater future, for a more sustainable, brighter future, we're losing. Now, you take the case of Singapore itself in this region. We have the perpetual haze which comes in the months of about August, September, October because of forest fires in Indonesia. Everybody talks about it. Governments talk about it. Companies which are responsible for that, they say not, we are not responsible. It's the smallholders. So there is, you know, finger-pointing going on. So what's happening is everybody seems to know the problem, but no one really is serious about solving it because it's always trying, you know, saying that it's somebody else's. But why? Because there is competition. It's about making more money. It's about being profitable. So in this kind of scenario, you know, sometimes when we come up with these kinds of efforts to try and do these noble things, we're actually on a losing ground. So one suggestion which I have is really maybe to get to the root of the problem, which I think is greater consumption. See, if we look at us across the world, rich and poor, including the poor, we are consuming far more than we have ever had. More food, more clothing, whatever that be. So as a result of which, there is a lot of commercial interests in order to cater for this greater demand. And everything is defined on that basis. So perhaps if there is a movement, real serious movement, encouraging people to consume less and companies trying to consume less, why is there a need to change your phone that faster? The company is pushing it, but why do you need to? Right? So maybe an awareness or something, a movement to say, consume less. Thank you.
Well, I think one thing is that we know very well from lots of studies that just telling people to do that is not sufficient. And what does matter, and this comes also to known methods of mediation and conflict resolution, is finding those things where people are not in it for the same motivation. So yes, there's business motivation, you want to make money, whatever. The question is, are there points along which there is a common benefit in a change in the process? And if you can identify those even as small pieces and develop a process around that, then you may be able to initiate those kind of changes. But you're right that there are very powerful interests, and that makes it very difficult. But I mean, that's nothing new in that sense. That is one of the major problems we will face and continue.
Andrew, last question.
Ilan, thank you very much for this. I agree with Jan's point. The minute you start with Anthropocene epoch, you actually mentally put yourself in a dead end. I'm posing this, you know, okay, because you're saying this, here's this disaster, we need to avoid it, right? But we then come to, you know, and this is a very measured scientific way of, you know, clear objective way of looking at this, when this problem is not a matter of just science, but of emotion and faith. Mm-hmm. And it's an area that, you know, I'm just suggesting that you may want to address this issue. Let me pose it scientifically, because Kenneth Arrow, who just died, had a wonderful impossibility theorem of collective social choice, which is what this is all about.
Yes.
And basically, I interpret his collective social impossibility theorem as you can democratically allocate gains, but you cannot democratically allocate losses.
Correct.
And if you argue that we're heading for Armageddon or inter-Anthropocene epoch, this is only about allocation of losses with very little upside.
But
okay?
Wait a minute. Let me just make something clear. Anthropocene is not a statement of doom. It is a statement that we have a large influence on the planet. And the question is in what way and how that changes. That isn't saying we notice that humanity has changed the world and now we're all dead. It's saying what is clearly the case, that we are influencing it, whether it's climate change, water, and any of these things. The question is, what do we do with that? And I would argue the point is not to be the doomsday sayers, but rather the opposite. My argument with Johan Rungström and others who pushed this planetary boundaries is that by itself doesn't tell us anything about what we do.
But you see, all we're doing with a capitalist model of consumption is unsustainable, and we know it. And we've got unsustainable consumption financed by unsustainable finance. Mm-hmm. We can create any amount of money to lend you to spend all you want to do, right?
Right.
You know, never leave home without it, okay? Right. But the issue is that we are now facing faith problems. That, you know, people believe that this is either, this is scientifically can be denied, or it does not comply with my faith.
Agreed.
How do you, if you don't deal with this issue, you'll never deal with this problem.
That's why the narratives are critical, and we have not addressed that. I agree entirely, because that's where the faith is expressed. I very much agree with that, Andrew. But my point was, and perhaps I failed to make this clear, the point is that just the science, in quotes, in traditional terms, will not be able to address this. It requires the narratives as well as the models, however elegant, that we have already seen in the last 2 days, and many more. But we need the emotional, the faith, the broader conception of humanity in this, and for that matter, living species in this story.
Thank you, Ilan. Let's thank Ilan again.
Give you this nice token of appreciation.
Lovely. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Here.